Chapter 2, Mapping the Business Landscape. Let's look at different industries in the United States over the last 20 years from 1978 to 1996. In second chapter, we see this image where we see a lot of industries which have high profitability, like pharmaceuticals, 15%. So this ROE is return on equity and K is cost of capital. So if you look at your returns on your equity, which is the money you've invested, how much return do you get minus the cost of capital, which is what is the cost of capital, which is in this case, it would be like what is the treasury yield, right, in the United States. And if you subtract the two, then you get profitability. And this is profitability spread on the y-axis. So we see a lot of companies super, super profitable. But we see a lot of other companies like steel, air transport, they are not profitable, like meaning they're negative. They return negative profits. So this is very important to understand as to which business you're in. Is your business overall a profitable business or not? This can have a huge impact on where you put yourself. And how you, once you know, hey, you are in an airline business, you don't want to compete with pharmaceutical profit lines. You want to figure out how to make the airline business better. So understanding where you are is a very, very important idea. And it summarizes with this quote from Warren Buffett. It says, when an industry with a reputation for difficult economics meets a manager with a reputation of excellence, it is usually the industry that keeps its reputation intact. So if you are a strong leader and you are in a bad industry, which is not profitable, then it's the industry that will keep the reputation of being non-profitable. So it's very, very critical where you are. The same person can have a huge impact in a better industry or in a better geography than somewhere else, right? So where you are has a huge, huge impact on your output and also on your reputation. Like if you have an excellence reputation, it'll be empowered in a company or in an industry that, you know, values that. So think deeply about this. I know I went too much into the detail, but like which company you're in is very important for you to choose. And so the goal of strategy is, in a sense, is to guide the businesses to profitability. It's all about profits, right? And so every industry here we saw, everyone, all the leaders in those industries are trying to get to profitability. And so that's what strategy helps us with. Like once you understand, okay, this is where I'm in, and now I need to understand, you know, hey, what are the reasons behind this being not profitable? So you then need to understand accounting, you need to understand the economics of supply and demand and all of that. And once you understand the reasons that drive that negative profits or subpar profits, then you can understand like, hey, what changes should I be making? Like, how does my business work? What is my company or my industry's business model? Like, what are people competing? Where are they competing? How are they making money, right? So once you understand your company, your industry, then you need to understand the reasons behind it. And then you can come up with ideas that says, hey, where should we enter? Where should we exit? Things that are not making money, you should probably exit if it's not long-term sustainable. How do you make those decisions once you know where you are? And how do you react to regulations, deregulations, major economic shocks? Like if, let's say there is a monetization policies, or like when government prints more money and pumps more money, like how does that impact your industry? Maybe you get positive benefits because now your workers are compensated by taxpayers' money. So all of those things that happen outside of you and where your industry is placed in, you need to make decisions. And that's where the strategy helps you. A strategy set of decisions that get you to a high point of profitability, maximum profitability that you can achieve. So this is a complex topic, right? There are internal changes, external changes, and lots of things changing. And so to give us some sort of a structure into how to think about this, there are three key things that I learned in this chapter. as a three ways in which you can, in a structured format, understand the business and an industry landscape. The first one, and this is in the history, the first one that came in was from Alfred Marshall, supply-demand analysis. And then it was evolved into five forces structured thing. And then it was evolved by Michael Porter. And then it was evolved to ValueNet by Adam Brandenburger, right? So these were like incremental ways in which how you structure your thinking to analyze and understand how is this business or how does this industry work, right? So there, to make this complex set of analysis simple, there is a structure now provided. So let's look at the first one, the supply-demand analysis. So demand curve, so on the y-axis, this is price, which is monetary, this could be dollars, and then x-axis is quantity, is the number of goods sold. So demand increases as the price goes down, right? So this is a demand curve. So the buyers follow the demand curve. They will buy more as the price goes down. And suppliers, over time, if they have to really supply a lot of quantities, typically the curve goes up. So it's upward sloping for the supply curve and downward sloping for the demand curve. Where they meet, that's the equilibrium point. Basically, it's saying, hey, at this point, all of these buyers, right, the one who is willing to pay, like, let's say $100, $99, $50, all the way to, like, let's say this is $10. Sum total of all of these buyers is what my supplier is willing to pay. And for supplier, for them to make, let's say, sell it at $10, they're willing to sell these many quantities. So where they meet is where you think, hey, there's least amount of profitability, actually, right? Maximum profitability, sorry. And so this is the equilibrium point. So you now think about this from a conceptual way of like, who are my suppliers? Who are my buyers in this industry? And what is the midpoint? What is the midpoint or equilibrium point where they intersect? What are my curves, right? First you need to, not all curves would be like a straight line. It could be like a quadratic function too. So first you need to identify what is your demand curve, what is your supply curve, and then you get to understand like, hey, where is my maximum profitability? My maximum profitability is when they meet. And so that's the quantity I will sell at the price that I'll sell, right? So that is the one way of maximum profitability. But it doesn't give you any insights. This supply demand curve doesn't give you any insights for like, hey, how are these shape of these curves formed, right? You have to do a lot of empirical analysis, industry analysis, run a bunch of experiments to find out like, hey, what happens when I change my price from $50 to $30 to $10? And then you will have to then eventually plot. So this doesn't give you that right off the bat, but remember there are a lot of key assumptions that supply-demand analysis has. First, that it's homogeneous, right? Like meaning a buyer will buy equally from this supplier versus that supplier, and you know there could be a bunch of these suppliers and there could be a bunch of these buyers. So it assumes that if I buy from this supplier that, you know, someone else would also buy from this supplier. But that's not necessarily true. Everyone has different preferences and everyone has a different choice of what they buy and what they will not buy at a given price and all of that, right? So the market is assumed to be homogeneous, both from the supplier side, meaning everyone produces the same goods, same quality. It's not the case. Every supplier has a different bar for quality, like an Apple phone versus a smartphone from Samsung. Two different suppliers and it could have two different curves. So there's no homogeneous market actually. So that's the biggest assumption. Second big assumption is law of large numbers here is also assume that each of these suppliers are so small that they may not have an impact overall on the overall supply. Or each of these buyers are individually so small that they might not be able to shift the demand curve overall, right? But that's not necessarily true. If the suppliers become like a monopolistic supplier or an oligopolistic supplier, then this curve changes. We know that the equilibrium point for the monopolist is not this one. It's somewhere here, right? Similarly, even for the buyers, right? They are not all buyers that... They could be like small enough. If let's say US government was one of the buyers, they could change the price. They could actually demand the price and actually change this. So it's no longer true to assume that all of these individual players are small. They could be much bigger. So that changes the thinking here. And a lot of times during various types of competitions, there are some big players, dominant players in play. And so that's the second big assumption. And then the second is like, and then the third is like, who governs value here? What's the meaning of value, right? Like, is it supply side driven, meaning, hey, if the price goes down enough that people would buy, or is it mainly utility driven? Like, meaning, hey, after a certain point, I'll not really buy more, like, let's say, clothes. So that's open too. It doesn't give you that perspective, like, hey, where is it? So that is the first way, supply demand, but it gives you two big concepts: who is a supplier, buyer, and then the price to maximize profits, right? The second evolution of this was the five forces by Michael Porter, right? So the first one, supply demand analysis by Alfred Marshall, five forces by Michael Porter. You see the suppliers are here, we have the buyers, so those are common, but he added these three new things in between. He added competitors or rivals, and he added, which is basically like, hey, for a given industry, it's not, you're not just working in a silo. You have a set of competitors that you're working against, and they constantly shape your profitability. If your competitor drops price, that you will have to, you know, adapt and change and react to it. So rivals and competitors was another big lens added into the structured thinking of profitability. And then he added these new startups and new entrants into the equation. Like, hey, there's these companies that are gonna disrupt this niche play, and they're now gonna take up that market space from you. And then there's substitutes, right? There, if let's say the price of butter goes up, then, you know, margarine is a substitute, right? So if you are in a butter industry, then, you know, you have to look at like the substitute effect as well. Michael Porter added these three new layers, right? New entrants, competitors, and substitutes. And so each of these five have a huge impact on profitability, right? So think about this. This adds more complexity, right? From this buyer-supplier to buyer-supplier, rivals, entrants, and substitutes. Now this gets us a new way to think about like how, what are all the forces that impact my profitability? Each of these have a huge impact in profitability. Value net, that's a third way, right? Look at the difference between value net and five forces. Five forces, value net. Five forces, value net. The only difference is they've added complementers, right? So these complementers are basically the ones that help you to win, right? So you can think about, if you're a pharmaceutical industry, then your doctors are your complementers. They can nudge, they can prescribe the patient to buy that product that you're trying to ask the doctor to sell. Windows PC, when it launched with 95 with Intel, then Intel and Microsoft are, you know, complementers. They add each other's value. Like, more Windows PCs get sold, they get sold with Intel, and more Intel chips are now sold, so then they both earn. And so the value net by Adam, they added this new concept of complementers. Like, who are your complementers and how are they adding value? And when the size of the pie grows, how would you like get the pie, you know, the slice of the pie that you deserve from your complementers? So adding this lens of complementers was a new aspect to value net. But think about this, right? All we've learned so far is that there is no one template. Again, complexity, you can keep adding complexity. You can keep adding more and more. But this gets us to a better and better way of thinking about like profitability and like what are the big forces that change the profitability of my business. And all we are learning through this is like, we'd have to think broadly. We'd have to expand our minds to not from supplier buyer to then eventually think about rivals, think about new entrants, think about substitutes, think about complements. So it's expanding our mind. And finally, you use all of this to do landscape mapping or like competitive analysis. The way you do this is you figure out like who are the key players, and then you draw the boundary saying, hey, if I'm, let's say, Nintendo, right? I can do a landscape mapping like this. First, I'll draw the boundaries. I'll establish the key players. Say, hey, I know my buyers are kids and parents and this Toys R Us, Walmart. And my new entrants are like, you know, the competitors are my Atari and others. Suppliers are like these microchips providers, Disney, Marvel. And then my substitutes are like, you know, those people who can compete for my games time, right? So for each of these, once they have done this mapping, they can come up with this action item which says, hey, I'm going to do these things highlighted in yellow. For my rivals, in this case, Sony PlayStation, I'm going to invest in a 3D technology because I know Sony is betting big on PlayStation with 3D. So I probably need to start doing something, otherwise I'm going to be screwed. So that's the action they're going to take for rivals. For competitors and for customers and buyers, they want a supply control so that, you know, they get the right level of demand for it, right? So they're going to control the supply because they probably realize, hey, the supply demand, it's probably best to limit at this point. For complementers, they are going to limit the title licenses, right? So to keep the symmetric developer versus game license agreement. So they probably figured out that, hey, if this becomes asymmetric, then it's not good for the business. So for each of these lands areas in their landscape, they have now put in a decision that they will implement. That decision is now powerful because if they start building this, then they're going to increase their barriers to entry. They're going to increase their power structure. They're going to increase their competitive landscape in such a way that it becomes harder and harder for competitors to compete with them. Right? So if they now suddenly start getting exclusive rights for game developers, now it becomes harder for other competitors to substitute them. So this is Nintendo's landscape mapping. And so the way you do that, again, going back to three steps, is you figure out the key players. In this case, it is Toys R Us, kids, players, Electronic Arts, Atari, Sharp. You know, these are all my key players. And then I'm going to calibrate my relationship. Like, hey, are these my competitors? Are they my rivals? And then I'm going to put them in the right bucket. And then I'm going to adapt and shape relationships based on some of the decisions that I've highlighted in yellow, which says, hey, I'm going to take these steps so that I can have the future that I desire as a company. So once you identify the key players, you would figure out the competitive versus cooperative landscape and how it changes over time that you envision. And then you map out the future based on decisions that you take, right? So this can get very complex because, you know, let's say I was thinking about my current industry, the talent management industry, the human resource industry. And look at the number of companies or the companies involved and the categories of work involved. It's recruiting, there's flexible hiring, there is... So basically, to give you an overview, tech landscape is we are in the business of hiring people so that we match people with jobs and then we match them at scale. But that's just one piece of, you know, recruiting or sourcing. But once those people are hired, then there could be a niche area of hiring them for flexible work, not full-time work. Then eventually you want to onboard them, and then you want to recognize and reward them, right? Then you want to have some sort of engagement once they are hired. You want to get them to learn new skills. You want to get to performance management if they are not working well. You want to give them the right amount of benefits and compensation. You want to give them, you know, their entire HR system so that you can manage them. So each of these are systems and companies that are competing for the same human resource play. And where do you fit in and how each of these are potentially your competitors or your complementers will help me understand, like, what is the relationship? Where do I want to invest more? What are my light yellow actions that I'm going to take? And that is part of my strategy. This is strategy. This yellow highlights are the strategic decisions made so that I can maximize profitability. Remember? High point profitability. That's the goal. How do you, within your industry, how do you get to maximum profitability? Because I've not read the future chapters, but I imagine within these industries, this could be the industry overall, but within this industry, there could be a few companies which might have positive profits too. So that's probably coming, is my hope. But overall, maximum profitability you get through structured thinking, supply-demand analysis, five forces, value net, building the landscape. I gave you an example of how Nintendo did it. Actually, this one here, I added my own. I'm not even sure if they did it because they failed miserably against Sony PlayStation. But if they were to add this for themselves, then that would be a phenomenal one. And so the final one, the tip on complexity, the analysis should be made as simple as possible, but not simpler. This is by Albert Einstein. I started with Warren Buffett's quote. Think about which industry you're in and ending with this for complexity, because it can be mind-boggling to just look through all of these companies and try to understand one line. So you'd want to start small, stay at it, understand who are your competitors, try to get the data and insights that are available outside as to how these competitors are competing against you, how is their social media presence, how are they engaging with their customers, what is their marketing spend, where are they marketing, which customers they're marketing, why are they going after that? A lot of this requires a lot of thinking, and this is pretty cool, right? We get to understand strategy, and we'll manage complexity in this way. To summarize, right, demand and supply, we have the buyer and the supplier. Five forces adds on top of demand and supplier the concept of competitors, which are rivals, and substitutes and new entrants. Value net adds one more layer of complementers, and it also makes the relationship two ways. So look at these two diagrams one more time. This is a two-way relationship. The arrows here are two ways, but here it's one way, right? So this is a huge addition, because some of these complementers can eventually become your competitors, and vice versa. Some of these buyers can eventually become your suppliers too, right? Because if they are huge buyers and they all have their own business. So now it's a two-way street. So that is another learning from ValueNet. And then landscape mapping is where you adapt, shape, start, stop, enter, exit, and you know, you make those decisions so that you increase your barriers to entry, you stop doing certain businesses that are not profitable, and you make those decisions so that you can map out the future that you envision to be, like Nintendo did it here, right? All right, that's the end. Super, super excited about the next chapter. Until then, see ya.